Welcome to Unfiltered. Here's tonight's headline, will they or won't they? New developments in the Kavanaugh confirmation. The ball is now back in Senate Republicans' court after a week of back-and-forth negotiations over the when, the what, and the how of a Senate hearing. Professor Christine Blasey Ford says she will testify in front of the Senate Judiciary Committee next week about her allegations that Brett Kavanaugh sexually assaulted her decades ago when they were in high school. But there is a lot of vague language in the letter that her lawyers sent to the committee at today's 2:30 p.m. deadline. It reads in part, Dr. Ford accepts the committee's request to provide her firsthand knowledge of Brett Kavanaugh's sexual misconduct next week. Although many aspects of the proposal you provided via email on September 21st, 2018 at 2:33 p.m. are fundamentally inconsistent with the committee's promise of a fair, impartial investigation into her allegations, and we are disappointed with the leaks and the bullying that have tainted the process, we are hopeful that we can reach agreement on details. The letter also asks for, more negotiations. So now we wait. It's hard to keep up, but here's how we got here. Earlier this week, Ford opened the door to giving her testimony to the committee. On Thursday, Ford's lawyer presented a list of terms. Those terms included that provisions be made for her safety, that only senators be allowed to ask her questions, that she not be in the same room as Kavanaugh, that he testifies first, and that other witnesses, including Kavanaugh's friend Mark Judge, be subpoenaed as well. On Friday, the GOP counteroffered, agreeing to hold a hearing this upcoming Wednesday, provided Ford testifies first and an independent counsel is allowed to ask her questions. The deadline for response was Friday at 5 p.m. That was later extended to 10 p.m. Ford's lawyer asked for an additional day to make her decision, and Senate Judiciary Chairman Chuck Grassley once again moved the deadline to 2:30 p.m. today, at which point Ford agreed to appear next week. And here we are. Here's the deal. This week will be a defining one, not just for the fate of Brett Kavanaugh and the Supreme Court, but for all of us. How will we decide to mediate these kinds of disputes in a politically fraught, high-stakes, emotionally charged election year and a Me Too environment? How can we handle this responsibly? The truth is, we don't know what happened, and we likely never will. So yes, we should have a hearing. Yes, Professor Ford should be heard, and Judge Kavanaugh should be allowed to respond to her accusations. But at the end of the day, we as a society will have to make a judgment call. Do we base that call on the character witnesses? Who has more of them, or whose are more compelling? Or maybe the actual witnesses? Well, they seem to favor him. Or is the threshold an FBI investigation? Is that what should be the deciding factor? Here's what I do know. Anyone who's telling you with certainty that Judge Kavanaugh is guilty wants him to be. And anyone who's telling you with certainty that Judge Kavanaugh is innocent wants him to be. So ask yourself, as we gear up for what will be one of the most important weeks in politics that will set a precedent for decades, maybe even centuries to come, what is the standard we want to set for future generations? All right, here to help me break down all the latest in this ever-evolving major moment in history, CNN chief political correspondent Dana Bash. Dana, the 2:30 deadline today came. We got the letter from Professor Ford's lawyers. Do we know how the White House has responded?
Well, there's frustration, which is understandable. It would be that the case for any president of any party for a nominee to be in this position, because the cards are in the hands of the Hill. Senate Republicans, particularly Chuck Grassley, the chairman of the Judiciary Committee, his staff, the leadership in the Republican on the Republican side, and to a lesser extent, the minority. And what is happening in my reporting, and it's becoming more and more clear, is that the absolute breakdown, unbelievable breakdown, even for today's times, of comity and of basic negotiation and discussion across party lines, which should happen in any nomination of this import, are not happening, and it's just the opposite. It is making things even harder. And so the answers and non-answers that you're getting back and forth between Senator Grassley, the chairman, and Professor Ford and her attorney are even more poisoned because of the poison atmosphere that it's in.
So to that point, is this going to happen? I mean, all the terms are still up for negotiation, right?
They are. Just as you said, the response from Professor Ford's attorney today was, yes, we accept, except X, Y, and Z. And the terms that you discussed, that you laid out so well, are still up in the air. Look, she wants to get to yes. At least her lawyers are making clear she wants to get to yes. And the Republican leadership should want to get to yes, because any other outcome at this point is very problematic, substantively and politically. So it's hard to imagine that they don't, but anything goes in this environment, it's sad to say.
Well, let's talk about the politics on both sides. On Friday, Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell insisted Judge Kavanaugh will be on the U.S. Supreme Court. Do you get the sense from other Republicans on the Hill, though, that they're less confident of that, or is that basically the line that you're hearing? We have the math.
They don't have the math. They want to have the math, and that was a line that Mitch McConnell used. It was, I think it was aspirational. It was also a political line because of who he was speaking to. He was speaking to a group of conservatives at a very important gathering of conservatives. And he also said, not just we have the votes, is don't get rattled, which I thought was really fascinating, because as much as we hear the pressure from the left and even from independents saying, you know, give her a chance, the pressure that I'm hearing from Republican senators and those in and around them that they're getting from the right to say what is going on here is even as big. And when you're talking about U.S. senators from really red states where their conservative base will make or break them, it's important not to forget that.
Wow. Okay, on the other side, do Democrats you talk to believe that once Ford testifies, it's over? It will kill the Kavanaugh confirmation. Is that sort of the underlying belief on the Hill?
No. You're right. Publicly, when you said in your open, it is so right that people who say that they just believe him without hearing him or without obviously knowing the facts, none of us know all the facts, are saying so because they want that to be the case. But truth serum, Democrats and Republicans, they don't know what's going to happen. And that is something that we have to keep in mind, because it's for both parties, it's the public that is going to have to decide this, but it's really these U.S. senators. And in particular, I would say there are four Republican senators who are the key here. Susan Collins of Maine and Lisa Murkowski of Alaska are probably the most important. Jeff Flake and Bob Corker also. But for the two women especially, if this goes down the way it looks like it is going to go down, and there is a hearing, and it's he said versus she said, it's going to be the senators who are going to have to decide whom to believe, and weighing that against the rest of the judge's background in the context of his experience and credibility. And that is a lot of weight to put on them. They are the jury.
It's going to be historic what happens this week or maybe next, whenever. Lastly, before you go, some Democrats I know I've talked to, I'm sure you have too, were not thrilled with the way that Dianne Feinstein handled these allegations. If this doesn't end the Kavanaugh confirmation, do you think this could hurt her reelection bid?
It's interesting because she's in this unusual situation in California where she's running for reelection this year against a Democrat. Right now, the poll shows she's doing fine. But, you know, the thing about Dianne Feinstein is that she I think maybe people would say, to her credit, she has trouble playing politics, and she plays the role of a public servant and a U.S. senator. And I was actually just talking to another Democratic member of the committee before coming on with you, because I knew you wanted to talk about this, SE.
Yeah.
And the feeling is that while there's certainly some grumbling, how could she hold this for so long, she made a promise to Professor Ford that she would keep this out of the mix, that she would keep her not just anonymity, but that she would keep her claim out of the mix.
Right.
And it wasn't, and if she had her druthers, she meaning Senator Feinstein, it would still be the case, because that was the initial wish of Professor Ford. But it was leaked, and it's now out of her hands.